And then that gave the camera some ability to move around. Problem was the blimp was huge and heavy, but it did silence the sound of the projector. So what they did was they then put the blimp on a dolly, usually. Times they would lay rails for the traveling shot, and the camera would walk, would move along and perpendicular to the actors who would be talking. It really, it was just a straight line, and it would last perhaps a minute and a half. Then technology came in, and gradually they found a different way. The Chapman crane was invented, and the first clip we're going to see is using a Chapman crane, which is a very, very big, bulky piece of work. And it has but soft tires, so it can roll. But there's so much you can't do with it. It's meant actually to be used on large sets, usually musicals, where the camera goes up and down. But it can also go backward and forward. So, and this is way before there was a zoom lens. Mm. So to make a long story even longer, the Steadicam was invented in 1975 by Garrett Brown, who's a Philadelphia native. And that really changed a lot because we no longer had to put down plywood or rails, and you had a lot more ability. The camera would move around the people. It could go up and down, and it made it very smooth. Now, the first take you're going to see actually looks pretty good. Mm-hmm. It's the only one that was not using the Steadicam. And that one uses the Chapman crane, and it's the very beginning of Touch of Evil, a film directed by Orson Welles, and there you are.
Yeah. This is in 1958, just for context. So this is just a little picture showing, in case some of the terminologies you didn't get, we were saying, that's a dolly on the left, basically on the rails that moves the camera across. Then there's also wires that was used for the movie The Passenger around the same time, actually, as the Steadicam was invented. But they would, even in early silent films like the movie Wings, they would fly across these rails and have like bungee cords to catch at the end. just the most inventive things you could throw a stick at. So basically what we're going to show you is so long ago, but just keep in mind that there are no cuts in the scene. The whole thing is one continuous take.
You hook to the internet in here.
Oh, that can't be.
Yes.
Stop.
This is my subduction.
I also like the second long take that's hidden, the 10-minute shot when you're inside the room.
Oh, the shoebox.
Yeah.
Funny, I remember the car blowing up.
Oh, I think it's, I think that's ahead, but this one's on delay.
Oh,
there it is. Yeah. There's the money shot.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that was before Steadicam, but things were moving along.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the next movie.
Can I see the next slide? Yeah. Oh no, I think for some reason that it's paused on the thing, so it's just stuck there. It's all good.
All right,
we're,
yeah. It's my
turn. Okay. Oh, gotcha. So here's a picture of how the Steadicam works, basically. And the way that there's a stabilizer in the bottom and a viewfinder as well, as you can see, like a mini screen that they could get feedback on to see what the shot's looking like. And there's Garrett Brown doing the shot for Rocky, which we're gonna show you shortly after this. But before we do that, what's great about this shot from Rocky, everyone knows it's very iconic. He's running from the top of the steps. But not only could you get a smoother motion, you had a lot more just fluidity and accessibility around the actors and the scenes. You can't drive a car up the stairs of the art museum unless you're like shooting a Fast and Furious movie and have $100,000. So you can just run up and do 360s. And that's one of the best parts of the famous shot is you can just see him orbiting around Sly. And you really couldn't do that before. So yeah, we're going to show you the famous clip after this.
And that also in that photograph there, it shows you the relationship between the cameraman and the camera. He's actually beside it. He's not behind it. Mm-hmm. And he's looking into a very small TV screen.
And no, Sylvester Stallone, I mean, he is fairly short, but there's a reason that they look so different is because most Steadicam operators are 6'4" or taller because it's so heavy. They have so much stabilization that they just need to have a full grasp on what they're doing. And even briefly before we show this, I want you to just kind of nod your head up and down and look side to side. And you'll notice that your eye, focus on a point in the middle, your eye will stay there. We're kind of like chickens. There's something in our inner ear that tells our eyes to focus on that point and keep it there. Cameras don't have that. So Garrett Brown devised this method to kind of make the camera more fluid and lifelike so that it can recreate reality.
Yep. Don't worry about it. I'm on.
Ellen. Yeah, sorry, we have like a little 5 second delay, but just it's such a great shot, not only just from like a composition color standpoint.
Look at that shot.
I know.
How many thousand people have tried to do the same thing?
Millions, you know. That is, if you can just see the vast difference, not in, I would say, quality, but just in terms of next we're going to show you a few clips of some other Steadicams and some more recognizable movies as well. So there's Marathon Man, which is from the same year as Rocky, and I think they have the same operator. And then we'll also show you one from The Shining, famous horror film, and just the different ways that they were used outside of just running. The second one you'll see is kind of an iteration of the same running from Rocky, but more for a chase sequence. So how do you take just kind of a casual training montage and turn it into more of an intense set piece, which you'll see, and then we'll get into The Shining after we watch The Marathon Man.
I would say also that the Marathon Man and Rocky, Garrett was the operator. It was a while before he developed, he trained and used other people. Mm-hmm. This was, they weren't sure, the editor wasn't sure, and so they put in two edits.
That's right, it's too short. It's too short.
He just didn't want it to be monotonous.
Did the Spanish dub on this one?
We always got it out of the way. Mm-hmm. Long way. Hot and short.
Yeah. Oh, is it playing again the second time?
There you go.
Yeah. So do you want to give a little spiel on just the way they did that one where you're telling me?
Oh, that actually the editor introduced two cuts into it because he didn't want it to be too monotonous. It isn't, of course, but there are two cutaways.
And that was a Spanish dub. That was a Spanish dub, mind you. That was not Dustin Hoffman suddenly changing his accent. So some of these clips may be higher or lower quality depending on what we could find on YouTube. But yeah, I love how you get that kind of the parallel motion with him. And it really helps you emotionally invest into the scene further than if it's more robotic, I think, if it's on like a dolly or rails. But with that, you're just kind of floating along with him, which I think is great.
Yeah. And by the way, that's a terrific movie. If you haven't seen it, you should see it.
Oh, yeah.
The key line is it safe?
Mm-hmm.
The vice angle.
The spoiler, it's not safe. It is the opposite.
It's never safe.
Never safe. Never safe. All right, now we're going to talk about The Shining. This was also Garrett Brown, who was recruited by Stanley Kubrick to fly all the way out to, I think it was Pinewood Studios in London. They had sets as tall as like, basically the Empire State Building inside this giant lot. I think it was the world's biggest lot at the time. And they used it also for James Bond movies. Yeah, exactly. The 007 soundstage. So most of you know The Shining. If you don't, it's a haunted motel adapted from Stephen King book about a caretaker who's just looking after it with his family, goes crazy. And things aren't what they seem in the hotel, especially room 237, which the son Danny is about to go by. So just look at how creepily smooth this whole take is. Yeah.
The sound is good.
So what's fascinating about The Shining and Garrett Brown's work on it is that Stanley Kubrick specifically wanted him there because he wanted the hotel to become a character in itself. He wanted you to feel like you were the hotel alive stalking all these people. And the best way was just to have this kind of just really sneaky, glidey work following voyeuristically charging at these characters. And another important thing is usually when people make sets, there are breakaway walls. So you can put the camera kind of behind or beside or above or up or down. And a lot of these scenes, and especially the scenes that take place in a giant hedge maze at the end, they were specifically designed to not break away. So you were confined, so you were claustrophobic. And he wanted the Steadicam, Stanley Kubrick, wanted the Steadicam to just further reiterate that and make you feel just so trapped. Not only is there a winter storm, you're in a hedge maze, but the set feels like it's closing in on you. So that's just a really, really methodical filmmaking. And then I think it's next. Goodfellas. Yeah. Is Goodfellas next?
I think so.
Yeah.
Goodfellas is one of the best known and one of the greatest. There you go.
I know it's very sensitive, the presentation.
It's also great storytelling.
Yeah.
Do you want to say something before?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It does a wonderful job of telling the story. It really moves things along, but it's also incredible because you start across the street on the passenger side of the car, and then the camera goes up and follows them into the nightclub and downstairs, and all along the way, it's integrated with other people who come toward the camera, and most of whom he tips, and how they bring their table to right to the front, and then how it right goes to Henny Youngman, mm-hmm. who starts to tell jokes.
Yeah,
but before you go to the airport, anyway, here you go.
Yeah.
Henry Hill, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's fine, we can end it there. Oh.
There he comes. And you go to the airport.
Yeah. So there are three things I want to touch upon in the scene. The first one is, if you actually study the geography, it's funny, they go into the kitchen and they enter one door, do a loop and come out the same door they entered, but you don't realize it because it's so well choreographed, kind of like a ballet, but there's no need for him to do that, but just to make the scene even feel longer, like he's ingratiating himself more in the community. So Henry Hill, the character, is kind of becoming more of a made man, even though he can't fully get there, because I think it'd be fully, your roots have to be traced back to Italy, right? Something like that. But it's amazing what they do with the camera and just make you seem like, make it feel like the environment's even larger than it is. The second thing I'm gonna talk about is how Garrett Brown also worked with the director Martin Scorsese on Raging Bull before this and was fired off of that because apparently the boxing scenes look too much like Rocky, but then they started working together again. So just, it's funny seeing the history of the Steadicam and the different directors that the operators work with and come back into, and it's a very symbiotic kind of bubble of people that work together in conjunction. And then lastly, this is the Steadicam long take. So we've shown you Steadicam shots that are what, like 30 seconds long, kind of like 45 seconds, but not really, don't have the excessive length that this has. So, you know, we want to combine the long take from Touch of Evil, the Steadicam clips, and how do you meld those together to create one kind of unified experience or sequence? And I think this exemplifies that probably the best in modern film history, in my opinion.
Okay, let's move on to Carlito's Way.
Yes, so we've seen kind of, you know, hints at Chase Steadicam with Marathon Man, we've seen horror, and this is with Brian De Palma, another Philly native, using that Steadicam to show a scene where Al Pacino is being chased by gangsters and he has to evade them in Grand Central Station. So enjoy.
Which is a nice big set.
Nice set.
Computer audio.
And then you can talk about the crane in the beginning of Boogie Nights, like goes to the Steadicam and everything, because we can like draw parallels with the Chapman crane and then that too.
Yeah, he comes down. Yeah, he did that of course in Bound for Glory.
Yeah. And
he steps off the crane. Yes.
I love it. Forgot it. There's some language in there, some four-letter words, but yeah, I just think it's so great how the camera travels down the escalator, but with purpose. It's not just for the sake of the camera getting down there. It's working with the scene, with the narrative, and how to get from one character to another. And it's very athletic too. I just think it's like a sport, basically. Not only the camera operation, but just how to get the scene to work best in the favor, then the technology to match up with it and enhance it.
Okay, move on to Boogie Nights.
Boogie Nights it is.
Okay.
All good. There are some movies where it's very clear that people just want to, you know, have a long take, and it's kind of just very showy and flashy. But I think when it services a story as well and can be kind of excessive, that when you have that combination, that is just the Goldilocks zone.
So rule of movie making is you don't want to call attention to the shot. It has to be well integrated and tell the story.
Earned, it has to be earned, yeah.
Ready for final?
Okay, let's go with the notes.
The fact that they get her dancing with roller skates all rides on her the entire take.
Yeah, the camera was on roller skates in the original
film. That's right.
And there's Maki Mock.
Okay.
So if that shot reminds you at all of Goodfellas, the Copacabana scene, is because Paul Thomas Anderson was directly influenced by Scorsese for this movie. Especially, it's how do we get the Scorsese kind of the day in the life of a gangster for the San Fernando Valley kind of porn scene. So that's why there's some direct parallels there. Yeah.
And the music's important.
Yeah.
The use of the music, and you don't usually have much music to travel shots.
Right.
Okay, in the interest of time, we're gonna move on to some of our favorite directors that aren't well known. I think some of them are very well known, but not by the overall public. And my first three, and my only three, Panama and Frank, this is the 1950s. Norman Panama and Melvin Frank, they basically worked together. They were a team like the Coen brothers, both writing and directing. There they are. Yeah. Okay. The important thing is, and the reason why I picked this particular film, is because there aren't many movies like it anymore. It's more of a situational, more like a farce. Now, there have been many, many really great movies. If you look at Preston Sturges and any number of Frank Capra and so on, and Billy Wilder and IAEA Diamond. This isn't the greatest of those or anything else, but it is rather remarkable. First of all, because it's in the 50s, a time when the movies were really mediocre for the most part. They were beginning to get movies, comedies were beginning to become like stand-up comedies with punchlines. This involves relational stuff, and I thought it was really good. Hilarious, in fact. I'm already laughing.
Well, I feel like most situational comedies rely on tongue twisters themselves. It's just very wordplay.
Magnetize the armor. Mm-hmm.
The poison is the challenge.
Anything you want to, any insights, any thoughts?
Well, I should have set it up. Basically, they've made, in order to kill Giacomo, the court jester, Danny Kaye, I won't go into why they want to kill him, but and that's Robert Middleton is the person that he's supposed to have the duel with, or the joust. At any rate, so they make him, they can't fight unless the jester is a knight. So it takes 2 years to become a knight. So they basically do it overnight, two days. And of course, he's just such a fish out of water, and that's what the whole basis of this is. And okay, next movie.
Night of the Hunter.
We have, Charles Laughton. Now, the reason why nobody knows that Charles Laughton is a director, he's famous as an actor, witness for the prosecution. He was the Hunchback of Notre Dame. He directed one movie, Night of the Hunter. But this is a very special movie. Robert Mitchum is a supposed pastor who is after the children. And one hand is love, and the other hand is hate. And the movie is pure Southern Gothic, and it's beautiful.
I'm trying to save. I know you did, Mr. Powell. I know how hard you tried.
The devil wins sometimes. Can't nobody say I didn't do my best to save.
Then oh, after that, it goes to an ad break on YouTube, so.
Yeah.
So what you heard him singing there is kind of the theme song of the movie, or what do they call it? The like a leitmotif or whatever, like that's his, before he kind of goes in for the kill, that's the thing that he sings out loud, which is great. And also, if you notice the love, hate, and I showed him the other picture, the knuckles, they look familiar. It's because in the movie Do the Right Thing, you get the character Radio Raheem, who has these kind of like brass knuckles, and he gives a speech to the camera about love and hate. So Spike Lee did a direct homage to that scene. And you've seen it in countless other movies or TV shows.
Like The Simpsons.
The Simpsons. I know, pretty much. You've probably seen a Simpsons episode for every
kid. But there is this, the grandmother, or I think she's the grandmother of the children. Shelley Winters is the mother who drowns. The whole idea is that he wants to get the children away from her. And she won't let him. Mm. And it's a battle between these two, good and evil. And that's Lillian Gish plays the grandmother, who was a major silent movie star. And she's great in this.
So, and she knows how to rock a shotgun, let me tell you that.
Oh,
she
can
blow any sucker away.
Yes. Yes, indeed. And finally,
Speaking George, of blown away, yeah.
George Miller. Okay. George Miller is best known. Well, he did all the Mad Max films. There are three of them. This is the third.
Oh, the fourth.
There's a fourth?
Yeah. There's one with Tina Turner.
No, that was the second.
The Thunderdome? I thought it was the Road Warrior, then Thunderdome. Whatever, it doesn't matter. But yeah.
Oh, he had Mad Max. Anyway, the Road Warrior series. He also made a movie called Babe, which is about a pig who can herd sheep.
And Happy Feet. He's animal feet. Movies, then yeah. Post-apocalyptic nightmare anyway, movies. So.
I just love this.
Great binary.
But the most important thing about Fury Road is there is no computer-generated imagery. This is all real. They rehearsed it, and it's death-defying. And it's just absolutely extraordinary. But also, it's great storytelling. Mm-hmm. It is just, you get swept away by it. It's absolutely fantastic. Of course, the machines and the costumes
and the color grading.
Yeah.
I love it. He speeds up the footage. And the I think frames.
The Charlie Sterling. Just to give you a slight idea there, these guys on the stilts.
Oh. It kind of reminded me of the drive over with all the unpaved roads in Chestnut Hill. There, I think.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right, you're on for your movies.
All righty, so kind of keeping in line with Ralph starting with kind of a screwball situational farce comedy, I'm starting with Women on the Verge of a Nervous Breakdown by Pedro Almodovar. He's a flamboyant, openly gay Spanish melodrama director who is just known for having very colorful, chaotic movies that kind of mix pop art, melodrama, as I said, and art house sensibilities. So some of his films lean towards horror, kind of drama, mystery, thriller. This one is probably his most overtly comedic. It's amazing. It's short. It's based off of Jon Cocteau's play, The Human Voice. I think it was a one-act play about a woman who is waiting for her lover to return phone calls, but he isn't, so she takes drastic measures. And that one, I think it's like rip a suitcase in half. And this one, it's burn a bed on fire and put Valium into gazpacho and try to drink so much she passes out. Anyways, one thing leads to another and a whole cavalcade of characters wind up in this one apartment, and it's just madcap comedy. It's hilarious. It's crazy. It's got dual gun wielding grandmas, as you see in that one picture. And I couldn't find any clips of it for some reason on YouTube, but I do have the trailer, which will give you more than enough of a gist of what it's going for. So enjoy this.
It's a place where the one thing you can't expect is the others.
So yeah, you can just tell from that like minute and a half alone, he just is all about just maximalism of just color, craziness, energy, costume. And as you saw the picture I posted of him, he very much is like the characters in his films, just very kind of histrionic and has a very great career. And actually he's been nominated. That was nominated for Best Foreign Film. I think his other movie, All About My Mother, was. And then last year, Pain and Glory, which is way more dramatic. And Antonio Banderas also got nominated for Best Actor for it. So he's a fun range, but usually the visual textures are the same throughout his movies. So next I have Tampopo. It's kind of a hidden gem from Japan in the mid 80s by Juzo Itami. And how do I put this? It is allegedly the world's first ramen Western. It is about an aspiring chef who runs into this trucker and she wants to learn how to make the best ramen in Japan. Very much like the titular food, it is kind of a hodgepodge of different styles, genres, sequences, set pieces, and just basically is about the exploration and love of food in life and especially in Japan. So given that range of just characters in this ensemble piece, you have kind of more PG moments, like people just slurping their ramen, then even more NC-17 moments of couples kind of doing egg yolk foreplay. Gives definitely a new meaning to the term food porn, if you will. That's, you know, we all know the BuzzFeed.
More like noodle porn.
Noodle porn, there you go, exactly, that works better. Basically, it's just very unique, but it has these crazy clashing tones, characters, and ideas, but all through the connective tissue of food and a train traveling around Japan that takes in each new location. So I can't even put to words what it's like, but it's just a very heartwarming and kind of exhilarating movie. And here's a scene about a ramen master teaching one of his ingenues. Basically you can just tell from that it's a very it's a very idiosyncratic film. It's kind of like visiting your grandma's if there was noodle play in the middle of it. So my next movie is not one but actually a trilogy. It's the Before trilogy by Richard Linklater, And
you don't have all three on
it. No, I don't have all three. No. Oh, okay. I chose one exit from the first one. But basically, this is by Richard Linklater. You all may know him from the movie School of Rock. But before he did more mainstream stuff, it was a little more of an indie darling. He's based in Austin, Texas, and make a lot of quirky character dialogue-based hangout movies. He also did Dazed and Confused, very popular. But yeah, so this is basically about Celine and Jesse, played by Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy, as a couple that evolves through time. They are two strangers that meet on a train in Vienna in the first one, Before Sunrise. Then 10 years later, literally filmed 10 years later in 2004, 2005-ish, they meet up in Paris as elder, you know, people and different versions of themselves. I don't want to reveal what happens to their future, but then 10 years later-ish again in 2013, well, that was before midnight. This is before sunrise? I think, sunrise.
Sunrise is the first.
Sunrise, sunset, and then midnight. Yes, yeah. Tongue twistery. Midnight is the last one. It kind of takes things in a more dramatic direction. But anyways, it is fascinating because not only do you see the characters change over time, the actors do, and their quirks kind of maintain that age range. And you can see how they develop and change and just watch this whole relationship grow. And I showed a clip from the beginning, the first one, Before Sunrise, and just look for attention to detail of little character quirks and kind of flirtatious elements between the couple.
We've known each other a little while now. We're stuck together, so we're going to ask each other a few direct questions. All right? This way, ask each other questions. Okay. Okay.
You have to answer 100% honestly.
All right, first question.
Describe for me your first sexual feelings towards a person.
My first sexual feelings, oh my god. I know.
Jean-Marc Flurry.
Jean-Marc Flurry. I remember I did so many times together. And he was a swimmer.
Yeah.
He had bleached out flowing hair and green eyes. And during Flurry's times, he shaved the air off his legs and arms.
Disgusting.
Oh no, he was like this gorgeous dolphin. And my friend had a big crush on him. So one day I was getting, you know, breastfeed back to my room, and he came walking up beside me. You know, and I told him, you know, you should take Emma because she has a big crush on you. And he turned to me and said, well, that's too bad, because I have a big crush on you. So, yeah, he really scared the hell out of me because I thought he was so fine. And then he officially asked me out on a date. You know, I pretended that I didn't like him. You know, I was so afraid of, you know, what I might do. You know? So, you know, I went to see him swim a few times at the swim competition, and he was so sexy, really, I mean, really sexy. You know, we kind of wrote this little declarations of love to each other at the end of the summer, and, you know, promised we would keep writing forever, and like, you know, meet again very soon.
So yeah, you get the gist of it. Yeah, very cute, and it's fascinating how they evolve over time and things go from jovial to a little more contentious and back around again. So yeah, that concludes both of our
recs. Really concludes the program, other than we strongly recommend these films, which are all very, very cheerful. They various range of farce, and except for Shaun of the Dead, which is deadpan Shaun.
Yes, farce. Emphasis on dead. Exactly. Yes. Play zombie comedy.
But Gross Point is also kind of different with John Cusack.
Yeah.
And so that's the end of the formal part. If you want to have any questions,
call us, beep us if you want to reach us.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, was it playing the Shaun of the Dead clip?
Which clip?
The Shaun of the Dead clip.
Oh.
If we have time for it, it's about a minute, but if we have time, it's fine. But if not, it's okay.
Wait, there's some questions.
Yeah, that's fine.
Wait, if anybody has them.
Oh, yeah, I forgot all about that. I'm sorry. It's okay. I didn't know it was there.
It's fine. Yeah, I snuck that one in. Does anybody have any questions, comments, opposing points of view? Put it in the chat. Write us, DM us, slide in.
Here's a question. How did both of you,
what inspired you to get involved with film? What was your first inspiration?
I was inspired by him, so then he has to talk now. So,
yeah. Thank you.
Really?
Yeah. That's well, I'm pleased. But basically, I saw my first movie, I think I was 3 years old, and that was it. I was just fascinated by what was on the screen, and I still am. I've seen a lot of movies and a lot of good ones, and I just love movies. And if they're a good movie, they involve me, I cry, I laugh, I really feel like I'm part of the story. And it's been a progression. Ultimately had a little movie theater in the basement. First it was silent, then I got a sound projector, and it sort of progressed. Now I have a movie theater with only 25 seats, but it's stadium seating and terrific sound.
And it's in those seats that I did the exact same thing at almost age 3, and then the process repeated itself. So there you have it.
Yeah, I introduced him to a lot of movies. We would show movies on Friday nights, and they were all good.
Exactly. Well, maybe not MASH. Nashville's okay. MASH.
Okay.
So we did have another question that asked us, how is the pandemic affecting the movie business?
Terribly. Mm-hmm. It's teaching people how to watch movies on television. And that's not the way to watch. A lot of movies you can watch on television, but you really need to be in a theater for the theater experience. There are so many movies that are just bigger than, I don't care if the television has a wide screen. It's not the same thing because you're not in a theater. A darkened theater, assuming people aren't eating, is the way to watch any movie. Not on an airplane, not at home with the lights on and the phone ringing and any kind of interruption. You need to sit down and watch that movie and give it the respect it deserves.
Exactly. And there's a lot of attention to detail that directors put in their work. Sometimes they don't, and that's evident in how you feel about the movie. But even in like Boogie Nights, there's so many different characters moving around each other, and the way that the camera lands on them when a beat drops in the song, and they're just little background like waiters who move, and then that takes the camera with you. And when you can spot that on a big screen, it just, you feel rewarded for kind of being in the same dialogue as the director. Like you feel that immediate connection with them, and it's kind of a reward system, and just makes you so much more immersed than if you're just watching it casually. Which there's nothing wrong with watching a dumb movie casually. I completely get that. If you have a long day, you want to do that, sure. But if you want to watch something that's very investing, you want to be able to see it in the best format possible, and you need a big screen for that.
One more question here. Do you, what would you say is your very favorite movie? If you had to pick one.
It's hard to do.
Waterworld. For me, it's a tie between Paris, Texas from 1984, which is basically about this estranged father played by Harry Dean Stanton, who's discovered wandering in the middle of the desert in Texas and kind of rekindles the relationship with his son and wife. It's just beautiful, kind of very moody, kind of a little light on dialogue, but it's like a very universal kind of approach to a specific story. And then the other one is Koi Onuskatsi, which is another 80s movie, which it's not really a narrative. It's more kind of time lapses and kind of a god's eye view of what life is like on Earth and how technology has changed it for better or worse.
The music was by Philip
Glass. Exactly. It's one of the best scores of all time. You're going to kind of feel like your brain's exploding while listening to it, but that's a good thing. It's very exhilarating and emotional and makes you feel like the tiniest ant to ever exist in the universe, which is good because it's humbling.
Yeah. We had another question.
High Noon. Yeah, that's the one I'm closest to. There are 100 movies that I truly love, 2001 and so on, but The Wild Bunch. Yeah, there are just so many movies. But High Noon is one that I pursued for so many years, and then I also met Gary Cooper. And he opened the door. I was out to win an award, and he opens the door at the Beverly Hilton Hotel. We're there to rehearse for the dinner that night. And he's pretty tall, and I looked straight up at him and I said, "Gee, Mr. Cooper, I've seen High Noon 52 times." And he said, "Gosh."
Is that crazy?
Yes.
And also, I like that it's secretly about the Hollywood 10, the blacklisting by the House of Un-American Activities Committee.
House of American Activities Committee, exactly.
Right.
We got another question that said, if you could only watch one movie in your life, which one would it be?
Porn.
Right. See, I got the food porn. I'm happy you just cut the food and got right to the jump, you know? No sugarcoating it, right?
That's too tough a question.
Well, I'm trying to think of a long movie. How about like War and Peace? Yeah, you know, I'm getting like 8 hours worth in there.
What was Warhol's movie, Empire State Building?
Oh, my Empire. It's literally just Empire, like, right. What, like 28 hours of the Empire State Building in slow motion.
You just watch each window ultimately go dark.
Oh. Mm-hmm. What is your favorite movie of 2020 is another question.
Well, I'd like to give you Jojo Rabbit as a recommendation.
Jojo
Rabbit, which is 19, it won the Academy. It got a lot of Academy Awards in 19. It is one of the best, if not the best, black comedy of all time. It is an incredible, incredible movie.
Yeah. I have two, because I can't decide yet. One is American Utopia, which is the David Byrne concert film directed by Spike Lee. And it's, I wouldn't say a sequel to Stop Making Sense, but it's a spiritual relation. And it takes kind of a lot of the elements of the original one in his music and adds, it becomes more of a protest film. And it's just beautifully choreographed and it'll just give you a serotonin blast. So I highly recommend that. It's coming, I think it was released on HBO Max last week. And my other one is Sound of Metal, which I just caught at a film festival virtually. I don't know how I snuck in, but I got there. And it's about a metal drummer played by Riz Ahmed who starts realizing that he's going deaf and how he comes to terms with that and his own kind of philosophies, because he kind of winds up at a faith-based deaf school. And he just figures out how to rearrange his life and, you know, go from this hardcore metal scene and doing his passion to, you know, moving to a different approach. So it is very emotional and he probably will get nominated for best actor, but Chadwick Boseman, everyone's saying that he might win for the new movie that he's going to be in posthumously also, because he's apparently amazing in it.
Yeah.
What is that movie?
Oh, it's an interesting.
We don't know. We never saw it. We never even heard of it.
I know, but just everyone's like, he's already the front runner. So I believe it though.
We don't know. We haven't seen the movie. Okay. I'd like to tell my wonderful wife, who's going to a 9:30 movie with me, drive-in, that I'm on my way.
Yes. You guys have been fantastic.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in. We will have this recorded, and we will send this out on Monday with a list of their favorite movies. And
go to the drive-in. Drive-ins are still open. Go to them. You'll have fun.
Thank you so much. Have a good weekend. Take care.
I know. Thanks very much.